Yes. Oh, it's not on here. They were nice to... they left that out for me. So y'all know we have come into his house, so let's just sing that one. We have come You may be seated, unless you had a birthday in March. If you had a birthday in March, we want you to come on down and have a blessing this morning, if you're able to do so. Come on down. Here we go. Thank you so much. Thank you, dear. Yeah, you're getting close to that dollar bill, aren't you?
I didn't plan
ahead. That's all right. That's all right. Anybody else have a birthday in March?
Sorry, April.
Well, I know. All right. So let's, what was the biggest blessing you had for your birthday this year, Miss Peggy?
Oh, just family.
Just family. That's a good one. How about you, Geneva?
Going up to
Illinois and seeing your extended family. Wonderful. How about you? And having your son's home. Very nice. Very nice. Well, let's sing happy birthday to these folks. And when we get to their name part, we'll just say God bless you. And we'll sing happy birthday. Happy birthday. Well, our first song this morning is a Revelation song. So if you would please stand, the words will be on the screen, and join us as we sing. take a moment and greet your neighbor in the name of the Lord this morning. As you make your way back to your seats, if you would turn over on the back of your bulletins. We do have a few announcements to lift up before you this morning. Just to remind folks, our group that we're doing our confirmation class, we're kicking that off again starting this week at 3:30 this afternoon. And then we have junior high youth and high school youth at 5 and 6 o'clock. Junior high youth is at the John and Rhonda Riley's, and high school youth is going to be over at Brandy Keeter's house tonight. And so if you have junior high or high school kids, you know, if you want to send them to youth group, that's where we'll be. Also, we've started back up with our pastor's Bible study on Wednesday evening at 6 o'clock, and we share a meal together, and then we have Bible study beginning at 6:30. And we had a small group last week, but we had a good discussion. So it's not going to be necessarily, you're not going to miss anything if you've missed last week. So come on down and join us on Wednesday nights. It's going to be a good time as we get a little deeper into the Word of God together. And then if you haven't gone over and checked it out yet, most of the new playground equipment has been installed at the city park. It really looks nice over there. We're very thankful for those that worked really hard to get that grant and make that happen. And in light of all of that being installed over there, I think it would be really great if we had our church picnic there instead of at Fort Belknap. So we're going to have our church picnic at the city park on Sunday the 17th. That's going to be a potluck dinner. And so we want everybody to come and be a part of that. And we've invited the Elbert Church to come over and join us so that we can all have a big time of fellowship together on Sunday the 17th, right after our 11 o'clock service here. I also need to meet with our administrative council for just a brief moment right after church today. We do need to approve one little thing as far as some stuff that didn't get done at charge conference that I forgot about. And so it'll just take a minute to do. And so if you're on the ad council, if you could stay for just a moment right after church and make that happen, I would appreciate that very much. And then also, Teresa's going to be preparing to send off care packages to our college students here in the next week or so. And so if you would like to help donate to that cause, you can give her some funds to help her buy the stuff, or you can donate things to go into the care boxes. So get with her after the service and just kind of see what she's planning and what she might need. And if we can all come together and help make that happen. I know the kids really enjoy getting those care packages every semester or so at college. It's a really neat ministry that we do. Are there any other announcements that we need to lift up? Anything going on in the community that we need to make everybody aware of? All right, what joys can we lift up this morning? What are we happy about today? Yes?
Celebration.
99th birthday party. Wonderful. Good. Very good. That is a joy. Wonderful joy. It is good to have Rob back. I'm sure he's glad to be back. That hospital bed gets a little old after a while, I'm sure. Be 80 years old. So we'll be doing a blessing for you into this month.
It's nice to have Matt and Michelle
living in Throckmorton. It sure is. It's good to have you guys back in Throckmorton. We're tickled to death to have you here. What other joys can we lift up? One more for the bus to pick up on Sunday mornings. Good deal. What else can we lift up as a joy this morning? Molly had a birthday as well. Very good. What else?
We had an awesome Sunday school lesson this morning. It was really fun. I think the kids, I don't know, I got a lot out of it.
Yeah, the Sunday school class talked about the body of Christ. And I think they have a display back here at the back of the sanctuary. When you leave this morning, you can see kind of some of the things they put on that display as far as what it means to be a part of the body of Christ. They even came and talked to some of us that were here early to kind of see what roles we played as far as being in the body. And it was a really good lesson for them. So we're so thankful for that curriculum and for our teachers who come on Sunday mornings and make that happen for our kids. A very big blessing indeed for our church. What else can we lift up as a joy this morning? I agree. I went and watched them here at the auditorium. I thought that was a wonderful play. I can't imagine who could have beat them. Wow. Well, we were real proud of them. Yeah, the kids did a wonderful job representing our school. If you didn't get a chance to go up last night and see all the kids show up to prom all dressed up, dressed to the nines, that was kind of a joy, too, to see them all dressed up and looking good and going into the prom last night. So I think that's a joy as well. Any other joys to lift up? All right, if you would take a moment, look at your list of prayer concerns this morning. Do have an update for you. Joe Self's surgery was very successful on Thursday. His throat's very, very sore this morning, and so that's why they're not here at church this morning, but they wanted me to pass along that the surgery went well. He's just anxious to get past the post-op of the surgery so he can start his treatment for the cancer that's still there in his body. So they just asked for continued prayers. Not only for Joe, but for Joanne and Diane and Marie and the whole family as they help him get through this time in his life. But things are looking good right now, so we're praising God for that. And I know Terry's doing pretty good. He's got his soft collar on, and he's trying to be good and not break the rules. He came to the cafe Friday morning. I don't know if Sandra knows that or not. He said he snuck out. But he was getting a little stir crazy there at the house, so... besides that, I think he's doing real well. So we're praising God that he's recovering well from his surgery on his neck. Are there any other updates or additions to our prayer list this morning? Okay, well, we're going to do things just a little bit differently this morning because we want to do something special today. One of the ministries that this church does that I think is so wonderful and special is we have a group of ladies that does a prayer shawl ministry. And what they do is that they get together and they knit prayer shawls for people who are going through tough times, or maybe who have gone through a tough times or have experienced a loss in their life, just as a way to show the love of Jesus Christ to those folks and help them know that they are loved and cared for. And so this, what we do is we all come down and we either lay hands on the shawl or we touch somebody that's laying hands on the shawl, and we pray over that shawl for that person as they receive it. And so we're going to make that part of our prayer time this morning, and I'm going to ask Sharon Gober if she would come down and receive this prayer shawl this morning. As you all know, Charles finally lost his battle with many, many ailments after many years of fight and struggle, and we just want Sharon to know that she's loved and cared for. And if you would kneel here, if you can, we'll place this around your neck, and then I'll ask everybody to come down, if you could, and we're going to bless this for her this morning. Yeah, if y'all could just want to touch the shawl. Very good. As I said, just place your hand on the shoulders of somebody else who's touching the shawl this morning. And that way, just like the kids' Sunday school class this morning, we are all the body of Christ, uniting together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just pray a special blessing over Sharon and her family this morning. We just thank you for her faith and for her love for Charles and for all of the years of giving that she's done. And so, Lord, we pray now that you would just give her a special blessing as she places this shawl around her shoulders. May she feel your presence. May she feel your touch. May she also feel the love and support of her church family that is here with her and will be with her throughout this time of transition in her life. And we just pray a special blessing over her in Jesus' name. Amen. If we could have some ushers gather at the back of the sanctuary, we'll take our offering for this morning. Let's pray. Lord, we pray that you would be here with us this morning, that you would bless this offering that we take, that you would let us give with cheerful hearts, and that these funds would be used for your glory here in Throckmorton and around the world. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Please rise for the doxology.
Praise God.
Be seated. Our scripture passage this morning comes to us from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. Hear the word of the Lord this morning. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." And Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I've always wondered, why didn't you write all that other stuff down? Have y'all ever wondered that? Man, I wish he could have written all that stuff down that Jesus did. He says, well, they're not recorded in here, but we just can speculate, I suppose. Well, last week was a party. Last Sunday was party time. Easter Sunday, the resurrection. You know, parties we often associate with Christmas and New Year's and birthdays and weddings and retirements. And yet in the lives of the followers of Christ, this is the party season. When people have said with their loudest and sternest, clearest no, God says yes. At Golgotha, people did their best to say no to God with great forcefulness. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, God with greater forcefulness said yes. Nobody expected that. Pilate said no in his hall of judgment, hastily washing his hands. The Roman army said no with its bloody and public execution. Custom said no with its borrowed grave sealed with a huge stone rolled in front of it. The women came to the grave, but their word was a sad no, because they came only to embalm Jesus' body. Peter later ran back to the tomb, but that was because earlier he had gone away, given up, withdrawn, and literally said, "No, I do not know him." Two on the Emmaus Road had said no and left town, the garden, and the grave. They had hoped Jesus was the one, but they left town with a disappointed no on their lips. In the upper room, the rest of the group gathered, hiding out in fear and grief. Jesus was gone. They would be next. Theirs was a terrified no. Unanimously, among friend and foe alike, the word of the hour was no. So when it happened, God's yes, nobody was sitting by the graveside, standing by the rock, or even hiding nearby in the bushes. And God, as he often does because of our dullness and disbelief, came up on their blind side, didn't he? Hope slipped in and surprised them all. No wonder Easter is the high water mark of the Christian year. No wonder churches are crowded on Easter Sunday. What a reason to celebrate. What a party. And look at the guest list. God is so extravagant as to invite everybody to the party. Well, you would think God would be a bit more selective, but we are evidence that God will invite anybody, aren't we? Well, the party was last week. That was Easter. The pews aren't nearly as full today as they were last Sunday. Resurrection, the party day, has come and gone. Have you ever been late for a party? I don't like to be late because I miss out on part of the fun. I have trouble catching up with what's going on. Someone makes a reference to a statement that was made before I got there. Everybody laughs but me. I don't get what's going on because I was late. See, today is kind of like coming late to the party. Well, we recall some of the excitement of last week, but we're missing the enthusiasm, the swell of emotion, the elation of a sanctuary filled with worshipers. Did you know that even on the Christian calendar, this Sunday is called Low Sunday? It's low Sunday emotionally and numerically. We might not notice the numerical low so readily if it were not for what happened last Sunday. But you see, one of the early disciples of Christ can help us with our journey today. Thomas came late to the party. He missed Easter by a week. All the others were in the upper room when Christ stood among them. He blessed them with peace be with you. He commissioned them with his own ministry. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. And he equipped them with his abiding presence. Receive the Holy Spirit. They really had a party. But Thomas missed it because he wasn't there. Have you ever wondered, where was he? Where was Thomas? Was he out getting a cup of coffee? Was he visiting family and friends? Where was he? There's no way to know where he was. We're only told where he was not. And have you ever considered this? Thomas was not locked up in fear with the other disciples in the upper room. Now our tendency is to berate Thomas for being absent. We berate him because there have been times when we have been late or absent and missed something important. We berate Thomas because he represents all those people who we think should be here but aren't. We berate him because when he was told about the resurrection, he refused to believe it. We consider that to be incredible. Why wouldn't he believe what the others told him? If you think about it, though, Thomas was no different than the other 10. According to Luke chapter 24, verse 11, when the women came back and told the other disciples that Jesus had risen from the dead, they said that was nonsense and they didn't believe them either. So why don't we berate them? We know so very little about Thomas. Actually, we don't even really know his full name. He's known by a characteristic. He was a twin. That's what Thomas means in Aramaic. So he's identified simply as the twin. And he's listed in the middle of the 12 disciples in all four of the Gospels. And whether that means he always was in the middle of things or that he was neither the stronger nor the weaker of the 12, there's really no way to discern. His few interactions that we have in Scripture with others give us some clue of what Thomas was like. When Jesus set his face toward Jerusalem, all of the disciples attempted to dissuade him from going, except Thomas. It was Thomas who said, "Let us go along with the teacher so that we may die with him." During the last meal that Jesus ate with his disciples, Jesus said that he was going away and that they knew the way to go where he was going. Well, maybe the rest of them knew, but Thomas didn't, and he was willing to admit it. He even admitted that he didn't have the foggiest idea where Jesus was going, much less how to get there. Now, I have a pretty strong feeling that the other disciples didn't have a clue either. Thomas was just the only one brave enough to ask. You see, to me, I like Thomas. To me, Thomas is a person of integrity because Thomas was willing to raise the tough questions. The kind of questions that everyone around is nervous to ask because they don't want to seem like they don't know the answer. Have you ever been in a room like that, in a class like that? Maybe you don't want to. Nobody gets the concept, but nobody wants to ask the question because they don't want the teacher to think they're all dumb, right? None of them thought you ought to admit that you didn't know the answers, except Thomas. Thomas refused to silence the integrity of his mind. See, for Thomas, faith and reason would be joined, or he would know the reasons why not. And this type of integrity is essential for emotional, mental, physical, and spiritual health. Now, there are plenty of folks around who clearly indicate that when it comes to matters of religion, you're not supposed to think, you're just supposed to believe. See, Jesus never told us that we're supposed to check our brains at the door when we come to faith in Christ. Thomas was one who said that faith was a matter of both heart and mind. Failure to integrate faith and reason was a breach of integrity for Thomas. See, a famous writer once wrote, "Your health is bound to be affected if day after day you say the opposite of what you feel. If you grovel before what you dislike and rejoice at what brings nothing but misfortune, Our nervous system isn't just a fiction. It's a part of our physical body, and our soul exists in space and is inside us, like the teeth in our mouth. It can't be forever violated with impunity. You see, it's a sad picture when a person is dishonest with himself and others by struggling to separate faith and reason. Seeking to please others by saying what is not believed and acting on that about which he is not convicted. Health is ruined, physically and spiritually. Thomas refused to take that path because he was a person of honesty. But Thomas was also a person of doubt. He was a realist. The world for him left no room for a resurrection. When a person was dead, he was dead. And he had seen Jesus die, and he would not settle for any hearsay comments or secondhand faith. These were an inadequate foundation for his belief. And in the midst of his doubt, Thomas did not put down the belief of others or attempt to force his doubts on them. When the disciples told Thomas that Christ was alive, did he say, "You're crazy. Surely you don't believe that. That's nuts." Neither did he say, "Well, I'll never believe such a tale as that." Rather, Thomas responded, "I won't believe this story until I have had a first-hand experience by seeing the scars and putting my finger in those scarred hands and putting my hand in that wounded side." You see, my friends, no person's faith can rest on another person's experience. Now, we may benefit from knowing about the journeys of others and what routes they have taken in their development of faith. We appreciate and are strengthened by comparisons and contrast, by similarities and by experiences completely foreign to us, but we cannot adopt someone else's faith. People have to move beyond the faith of their parents, teachers, and friends to a faith that is theirs. Otherwise, all they have is hand-me-down religion. And hand-me-down religion won't survive the first serious crisis or test that it faces. Second-hand religion has little, if any, genuine faith in it because it just accepts what is handed down without question. Second-hand religion doesn't usually survive the first serious grief, the first major temptation, or the first year of college. Some don't have much religion to lose, and what some have isn't worth keeping because it really wasn't theirs in the first place. When the disciples told Thomas about the resurrection, I'm sure there was a part of Thomas that wanted to say, "I believe." After all, 10 close friends could not be possibly wrong, could they? But Thomas could not honestly say, "I believe." What he could not say honestly, he would not say. And he wasn't going to fake it. The philosopher Martin Buber observed, "The atheist staring out from his attic window is often nearer to God than the believer caught up in his own fake image of God." In this same direction, philosopher Paul Schilling commented, "The serious atheist who wrestles with ultimate questions is likely to contribute more to intelligent understanding of both God and man than the pious believer who placidly accepts prevailing views." Now, many within Christianity have been suspicious of inquiries which might upset the supposedly revealed truths of the church. I don't know if you remember your history or not, but there was a couple of guys named Copernicus and Galileo who decided or found out through science that the sun was what the earth revolved around, and the people believed before then that the sun revolved around the earth, and they found out that the earth revolved around the sun. And when they presented those findings, they were charged with heresy by the church. Thomas was a person of honesty and a person of doubt. He refused to say he believed when he didn't. Please notice that there is no record in the Bible of coercion by the other disciples to try to force Thomas to believe or to tell him that he had to. There's no indication that refusal to believe Christ had been resurrected was a threat to the cohesiveness of the group, or that any of the disciples rejected Thomas because of his initial disbelief. You don't hear in anywhere in Scripture where they say, well, you know, Thomas, because you're having a hard time believing this, I just don't think you can be a part of our group anymore. You need to leave. Thomas, and I think the other disciples, realized that no one's faith can rest on another person's experience. His faith in God had to have a firsthand experience. Thomas was a person of honesty. He was a person of doubt, but he was also a person of commitment. Thomas had been straightforward with his observations and honest doubt. He needed some firsthand proof of the resurrection, and I wonder what his immediate reaction was a week later when Jesus appeared with the disciples and he invited Thomas to touch his scars. Thomas must have said, "How did you know I said that?" And suddenly Thomas no longer needed any proofs. Without touching Jesus at all, Thomas exclaimed, "My Lord and my God." And Thomas now had faith. Thomas had come late to the party, but he caught up in a hurry. "My Lord" would have been a sufficient address for Jesus, a magnificent address really, but Thomas spoke to Jesus as Israel had spoken of Yahweh, "My Lord and my God." These are the last words of a disciple recorded by John. Thomas had said all there was to say. Now, we have often berated Thomas, calling him Doubting Thomas. Why have we not given equal time to the leap of faith expressed in his confession and commitment and called him Believing Thomas? In the presence of Christ, Thomas's faith was made whole. Doubt dissolved and assurance emerged. The honesty of Thomas was still intact, and his confession was a statement of fact. Now, John closes this segment of Scripture this way: "These have been written in order that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through your faith in him you may have life." See, John is talking about the readers of his gospel, us. The Bible is intended to produce in us the kind of faith that emerged from people like Thomas. This kind of faith begins with honesty. Everything's on the table. Faith and reason learn to work together. No questions are dodged. No convictions are silenced. If doubt arises, so be it. Because doubt can be beneficial sometimes. As someone has said, doubt is the mother of faith. Now, you may have come to genuine first-hand faith in the resurrected Christ in another way, and that's wonderful. Celebrate. Maybe Mary Magdalene or Peter or some other disciple or biblical character is the model of faith for you. But for me, Thomas is a partner and brother in the faith. So I wonder, how is it with your soul this Sunday after Easter? Is your faith your own? Or are you still trying to live on the borrowed faith of another? Have you had that moment when you have experienced Jesus Christ in such a way that all you can say is, "My Lord, my God"? Or are you still living on mama's faith or grandma's faith or another person's faith? If you're living on borrowed faith, then friend, you're living on borrowed time as well. Because you can't use the faith of another to be in a relationship with God. And someone's faith may have gotten you to this point, but now it's time to make it your own. If you've got questions, ask them. If you have doubts, express them. But you can't just sit there saying you believe because somebody else does. If you still need to come to faith in the risen Lord, don't quit. Don't give up. So you have doubts and questions. So you're struggling with reconciling faith and reason. I commend Thomas to you. He's the patron saint for all of us who would come late to the party, but still we come. And as we come to the table this morning and we celebrate Holy Communion together, maybe this is the Sunday that you ask God to be real for you. May it be a time when you recommit your life to Christ, or maybe give it to Him for the first time completely. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank You. I thank You for Thomas. And even though we see him in a negative light so often, sometimes it's good to know that You still love us even if we have questions, even if we have doubts. I pray, Father, that You would help us to understand that it's okay to have questions. It's okay to even have doubts, but it's not okay to not try to find the answers. So for those this morning who may be struggling with their faith, with questions, I pray that You would put within them the desire to seek the answers, because You promise that You'll be there to help guide us to the truth. And for those of us who are secure in our faith and have no doubts or questions, I pray that You would help us to be good role models and help others move along in their faith journey by loving them like the other disciples accepted and loved Thomas until he came to a point when he could make the faith his own. And as we come to Your table this morning, may we come as one body, united in Christ, and leave this place as Your disciples to the world around us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we prepare to take communion this morning, if you'd like to follow along in the hymnal, it's found on page 12, or the words will be on the screen for you to follow along that way. Hear the invitation this morning. Christ our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. You know what that statement means? Have you ever thought about it? It means this is not our table. This is the Lord's table. And anyone who repents of their sins and seeks to live in peace with each other and who love God, anyone is welcome to come to it. So therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved You with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done Your will. We have broken Your law. We have rebelled against Your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. And then on page 13, the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to You, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with Your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise Your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of Your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are You and blessed is Your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of His suffering, death, and resurrection, You gave birth to Your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which He gave Himself up for us, He took bread, gave thanks to You, broke the bread, gave it to His disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is My body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." When the supper was over, He took the cup, gave thanks to You, gave it to His disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is My blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us do say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. For those who are going to assist, we'll be taking communion by intinction this morning. We'll give you a piece of bread. And you'll dip it into the cup and then eat the bread. And then you can spend time at the altar praying. The table of the Lord has been prepared. You may come as you feel led.
Dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus. Cry to Jesus. Cry to Jesus. Amen. Oh, and when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, then go in peace and laugh on glory's side, and fly to Jesus. Fly to Jesus and live.
Closing song this morning is, you'll also have the words up on the iPad this morning. If you would please stand and join me as we sing our closing song this morning. Before the benediction, just remember we will have a brief ad council meeting here at the front of the sanctuary right after the service. And then immediately following the benediction, you will be dismissed. We won't have our little closing song that we sing at the end because we have no one to lead it. So receive this benediction. May the Lord Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit, to the honor and glory of God the Father, bless you and keep you. And may your faith become your own so that you may truly be a disciple of Christ. Amen.